The views and opinions expressed on this program are those of the producers and the individuals appearing on this program and do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of the staff of the Sun Prairie Media Center, its members or underwriters, the board members of the Media Center Commission, Charter Communications, TDS Telecom, or the staff and elected officials of the City of Sun Prairie.
And welcome to Real Reviews. My name is Jamison Rabbit. The man seated next to me, I don't have to make up a fact, it's his birthday today!
That's not true. Why would you say something like that?
We're having fake birthdays?
Yeah, fake birthdays.
Man.
Yeah, I don't need people knowing this.
Once they find out,
I can't lie at the...
Send your presents to Real Reviews, care of Mike Roth. Happy birthday, sir.
Thank you
I'm
very
excited
much.
To be able to Thank spend you. Your birthday with you
right
talking
here.
About amazing movies.
I'm happy about this, too. We got amazing. Yeah, we have one and then one not.
And we have another one. But first, let's get into this week's streaming spotlight. It is a film that can be found on your Netflix, and it is a film called Psychokinesis. Psychokinesis is a South Korean film. It is the first superhero film to come out of South Korea. Kind of interesting. It is from director Sang-ho Yeon, who a couple years ago directed a great film, a great zombie film called Train to Busan, which I absolutely loved. This one stars Sing-rong Ryu as Suk-hoon. Suk-hoon is a bank security guard who gains these telekinetic powers after drinking some mountain spring water that had been tainted by a meteor. He doesn't quite realize he has these powers at first. You also have Yoon Kang Shim as Rumi. Rumi is his daughter, who they're estranged from each other. She's a small business owner who is trying to fight back against this mob-run construction company that's trying to kind of force her out of her spot so they can tear it down and build their own thing. Mm-hmm. She's fighting back. During the initial fighting against this mob, her mother is killed. She goes to tell her estranged father, Suk-hoon, and... tells him the news, and he's none too thrilled to hear about this. He's just starting to figure out these powers. His first power is he can make a lighter come to him across the room, almost like the Force, the lightsaber. He can make a lighter fly across the room.
Uh-huh.
Nobody thinks it's cool. Everyone thinks it's just a magic trick. He's trying to show people, like, I think I got something going on here. And everyone's like, yeah, great trick. Even his daughter kind of poo-poos this power that he has. Because she kind of doesn't trust him anyways. They're estranged for years.
I'm still amazed when people do that quarter thing. And I know they just have it behind
just roll
them.
It.
But, you know, I'm amazed.
He's doing things. He's and so one of the first times he really, really stretches out with his powers is he uses them to build a barricade around the small businesses that are being kind of taken over by the mob. So that these small business owners are protected. And suddenly he's like the little local hero, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone loves him. He's great. And these powers just kind of start to build and build and build to the point where he kind of teaches himself to fly, basically, by using these powers. It's a really interesting movie because the villain in this movie is kind of slapsticky.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like a serious film, but there's a lot of slapstick thrown in. Like the tone will go all over the place.
Yeah, the trailer made it seem like there's some funny bits.
Like, you know, a woman is killed by her head hitting the curb, and then, you know, maybe 20 minutes later, somebody's going to get hit in the face with a fish. You know, I mean, it's that kind of thing. And if you into that, it's kind of enjoyable. So there's this, the villain is. He's over the top. He's pouty, you know, and just like, I can't get my way. Tries to be menacing, and it doesn't always work. And so that's enjoyable. And it's a movie that ultimately comes down to, like, our hero here, Suk-hoon, kind of finding his humanity, not through his powers, but through reuniting with his daughter, you know, and that the powers are just a way of getting there and actually becoming the dad that he never was is what makes him the hero as opposed to these superpowers. So it's kind of a nice little message with this story. And like I said, it's the first superhero movie to come out of South Korea. I'm amazed after we have like a billion superhero movies, they finally have one. That's got to be incredible.
That is pretty cool.
That's got to be great. You're in South Korea and you finally get, you hear about all this stuff going on overseas with superhero movies coming out every 6 weeks.
Yeah. Yeah.
We have our own. And so ultimately, it's an enjoyable movie. I gave it somewhere between a 3.5 and 4 stars, I would put it. It's worth the watch. It's on Netflix. It's about 2 hours long.
I'll have to check it out. I do like those old movies. There was a movie called Cashier, and it was a long time ago, but it was a live action, and it kind of had that feel where every power was really extreme.
Yeah.
This looks interesting.
Yeah,
I'll check it out.
Check it out. All right, moving on to what we have on the marquee, sir.
Our major release? This was the major release everywhere.
This was in every theater.
One major release. We have The Possession of Hannah Grace. Originally, it was going to be called The Cadaver, but they changed it.
I had seen The Cadaver listed in some places.
Yeah, this is The Cadaver.
Wow.
When you go through the names at the end, Hannah Grace is also known as The Cadaver because I think that's what it
was
originally.
That had me confused for a minute.
Yep, this is Cadaver. Well, anyhow, on to the review, directed by Derek Von Rugen, I would assume. Shay Mitchell, she plays Megan Reed. She has had a traumatic experience in her life that she's starting to recover from. One of the things that she needed to do was to stop drinking and abusing drugs, so she takes a night job at the morgue, because I mean that's when people usually go out and drink and stuff like that. She's going to avoid all that stuff, just kind of work on herself.
Smart girl.
Yeah. Unfortunately, this is not the right job for her. On her very first day, she gets a body that's possessed by a very, very powerful demon. Hannah Grace, played by Kirby Johnson, who's originally a dancer, she is actually what I felt like was one of the highlights of this movie. I'm not saying this movie's good yet. I'm just saying she was one of the highlights of this movie. She's a dancer by trade, and they do this a lot with monsters. They will put a dancer, someone who's really good at movement, as
controlling their body.
Controlling the body. And the way she portrayed this character was really creepy. And another thing that I think this movie excelled at was the makeup department on this stuff really made some gore effects that looked real. You could just look at the stuff and just been like, ah! And I really like the setup of the building. I doubt it was a morgue. I'm sure it was just some kind of utility building. But the building was creepy. Now, the story itself, very, 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 very predictable. The jump scares, they even failed on. They
really
would do weird things, like someone would already be in the room, but there was no way he could have been in the room, and all of a sudden it was a surprise.
Sure.
The jump scares were off, where you would see something, and then they would pound in the sound. So it felt confusing. It was like, should I have jumped when I first saw
him? When do you want me to jump?
Or should I jump when the sound came? They did give it a really creepy atmosphere, but they did nothing original with this. Mm. And I think you were saying earlier, just feels weird that we would have something like
this. Yeah, it's an odd time for this
movie. And I couldn't even figure out why they would change the title. Does calling this Possession of Hannah Grace really
make it better
compared to Cadaver?
Cadaver actually sounds more like a art house film. Like, oh, what's art house? Cadaver, that sounds like Raw last year.
Yeah.
Like, oh, what's Raw? That's a cool cannibal movie. Cadaver would have me interested. Possession of Hannah Grace sounds like in the placement in the calendar.
Yeah.
Feels like B-level horror movie to me.
I feel like around Christmas time, we always have one horror movie, but
sometimes it's like Krampus and it's good.
Yeah. Or I think we had that one, Drag Me to Hell. I think that was a Christmas one, too. But this one didn't feel good. Usually the horror movies that come out around Christmas time are pretty decent. Did you see this?
I did not.
Oh. Well,
sounds like I missed out on something.
You deserve some high fives after the show. I'm giving this a very high score. I do like horror movies, and I do give credit where credit's due. It's 2.5, but I went with two people. Both of them hate it. I did see someone leave the theater pretty early. I might have just really appreciated the aesthetics of the movie.
Yeah, I was just going to say, if the aesthetics worked for you, that's a big piece to it. Yeah. I mean, the storyline was, is predictable. But
everything else just didn't quite work out. There was this monster also creepy, but also had this all power where he could just stand in one spot and people would be crumpled into a ball. It's like, why'd you chase him in the first place? You have this all power. But okay, either way,
Don't worry about it.
2.5. That's what you get.
I love it. All right, the next movie we have on the marquee is a little bit better. It is the new movie from Peter Farrelly. His first movie, I think, breaking away from his brother. I mean, the Farrelly brothers, known for their lowbrow comedies.
Uh-huh.
Right. This is kind of the opposite end of that. Peter Farrelly with the movie called Green Book. It stars Viggo Mortensen as a man named Tony Lip. This movie is based on a true story. And the screenplay was written by Tony's son, along with Peter Farrelly. Set in the early 1960s, Tony is a streetwise New York Italian guy who's kind of tied in with the rough crowd. You know, you can expect who. He's a guy that you can turn to when you need things done. You know, he's a trustworthy guy, but he's, you know, it's early 1960s. He's got very typical prejudices about other ethnicities.
Mm-hmm.
And so is everyone that he's around, because he's basically surrounded by a family and very like-minded people. He's out of work at one point from working at the Copacabana, and he is offered a job as a driver / security guy for this eccentric musician by the name of Dr. Don Shirley, played by Mahershala Ali. And he is going on tour of the Deep South in 1961. Dr. Shirley is an African-American. This is going to be some problems.
Especially
the fact that he is very eccentric. He's very well-spoken. He dresses, I mean, when they first meet, he's sitting literally on a throne with elephant tusks and in flowing robes.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's almost like you could say that it's a reverse Driving Miss Daisy, where he's in the back and he's got this white guy driving him around the Deep South. That's going to draw some looks as you're working through, you know, Montgomery and such.
Mm-hmm.
Neither guy particularly likes each other at the beginning of the movie.
No.
They both kind of, you know, Tony's a man of his word, which comes into play here. Like, he doesn't get dissuaded, despite the fact that he doesn't necessarily like this guy.
Mm-hmm.
But he's doing a job. He's going to do the job.
Yeah.
And, you know, both of them, neither one of them like the other guy. They both think that they're better than each other in very different ways because of the way they talk. And I think it was kind of funny that, like, accents in this movie come into play. Tony's got a very thick, you know, street tough accent.
I love the contrast of intelligence. And you could tell that's the reason why Dr. Shirley, he thought he was better.
Mm-hmm.
Because Tony Lip, he was not a smart person. And I like how Shirley, he helped his character grow.
Mm-hmm.
At first, he was pretty racist. He didn't know how to communicate very well with other people. He was pretty pig-headed about, mm-hmm. I'm fine just the way I'm at.
Right.
And then he just kind of grows and becomes more of a person. For Don Shirley, he also grows as a person. He becomes more complex through this whole movie. He is a very smart person, but there are things you could learn from people who aren't as smart as you as well.
Well,
and I like that.
And there's the dynamic of Don Shirley not being comfortable. He can't be comfortable. He's got this stiff upper lip at all times, so he doesn't fit in with the African Americans.
Mm-hmm.
He, you know, they look at him and go, you think you're better than us? But he also realizes as he's going around and he's playing at these super elite clubs, these white only places, old plantations and stuff. And they bring him in and they treat him like one of their own. But as soon as he walks off the stage, it's, you know, back of the bus boy. And the racism is directly in your face again. And so he's caught in this bind of, I can't fit in anywhere on my own.
I love how they portrayed him as a hero through this. This wasn't just something because he had a contract. He wanted to do this.
I loved how they
infiltrate
this
very racist culture. And instead of giving him reason to hate, they gave him reason to respect.
Yes.
And
a great reason when they explained why he was doing this. Why would you put yourself through this? Why come down here? You could make three times the amount of money up north.
Yeah.
And the reason why, and I think Mahershala Ali was great in this role. Like I say, he's got this stiff upper lip, but his vulnerability peeks through the cracks of his character,
mm-hmm.
as you start to see some of the things that he's not perfect, that he's not this hard shell of a man, that there's things about him, and he actually does care about what people think, and ultimately starts to care what Tony thinks of him.
Mm-hmm.
And that these two really, I mean, the whole movie, it's a road trip movie, and you know, the plot of it is kind of basic as far as that goes.
Yeah.
But these two start to learn from each other, you know? And you see that in a lot of these great stories about two different ends of the spectrum, and we can learn about each other and find our humanity between that.
And they both became better people because of it. It wasn't really one-sided. I had a feeling it was kind of like Planes, Trains, and Automobiles at the very end. Really felt like that movie. But
absolutely.
In this case, you had two characters that you got to watch grow, and there was never a lull. I really, really enjoyed this movie. My complaints on it, and I really had to search for complaints. I didn't think it was visually as spectacular as I would want a great movie. And Tony Lip's accent, it kind of kept on reminding me of Jersey Boys. And sometimes it felt
like
it was
supposed to be.
Viggo Mortensen, he's great, but that's not his accent. So every once in a while, it felt like this is not natural for you. But for the most time, I really was convinced that he could have been Tony Lip.
My only complaint really was that the story was kind of formulaic as far as the road trip version, but I think the actors really overcame any of that. I think the two performances, it's Viggo, it's Mahershala Ali, Linda Carlini as Viggo's wife, Dolores, but really it's just these two guys kind of going through the world for the most part, and their dynamic together felt authentic to me. And you see the real guys afterwards, and you're like, yeah, okay, I can see these guys, you know, they start to care about each other after kind of being branded through fire with some of the things that they went through. And it could have been very easy to turn and say, no, I'm done with you, or I'm done with you. Mm-hmm. I really enjoyed that. And you talk about his accent. And I like, because I think that their dialect and their accents and just the language that the two of them use really helped to, at the beginning of the movie, to like set up these barriers between them where, you know, Shirley looked down on Tony because of how he talked. Mm-hmm. And it kind of echoes the racism of like, you know, I'm not willing to look below the surface. This is how you talk, so you must be this guy.
But I think,
and it's, you know, it really mirrored the racism in this movie to me.
And in a way, I think Tony also looked down on Dr. Shirley because of the race.
Right.
And I loved how...
The race and the fact that he didn't even know... You don't know who Chubby Checker is?
Yeah.
How do I know more about your people than you do?
Well, all that stuff felt horribly racist at the same time. But the message was really complex. Yes, the story was formulaic, but what was happening with these characters, what they were saying with this movie, that was spectacular. That was beyond... And it's also a Christmas movie. If we could call it a Christmas movie, because they mentioned it, and we're going to do that whole Die Hard thing. But and as far as it goes for Christmas, this is the message that I want people to take away from a Christmas movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about getting stuff. It's not having a hip Santa Claus that is totally different than anything else. It's about people learning their differences and just being peaceful with each other. And I absolutely love this film.
I did too. I really loved it. I loved Mahershala Ali's portrayal. I liked that he never felt totally comfortable.
Yeah.
You know, I liked that he felt awkward, and it felt real to me. I really liked it. And as we're talking today, as we're doing the show, the Golden Globe nominations came out.
Yeah.
And so both Viggo Mortensen and Mahershala Ali were nominated for Best Actor and Best Supporting Actor.
Uh-huh.
Peter Farrelly was nominated for Best Director, and the movie was nominated for Best Comedy or Musical.
Wow.
The Golden Globes are always fun. I mean, there's music. It's music adjacent.
And there is
there's music
parts.
Played in the movie.
Yeah.
So it's a musical or comedy, not a drama.
No.
But it's being recognized. And I think it's amazing that Peter Farrelly, who has just been known for making, you know, Me, Myself, and Irene, and all of these really Stuck on You, and these lowbrow comedies that are a lot of, you know, boner joke movies.
Mm-hmm.
That it reminds me of a couple years ago when Adam McKay broke away from doing, like, Will Ferrell movies and did The Big Short, and we're like, "Well, that was an amazing movie."
That was.
Holy cow! Where did this come from? Mm-hmm. You know, and now he has Vice out this year, which is another like Oscar-nominated type movie. It's interesting when a filmmaker late in his career can make a complete change from what he's been doing for 30 years.
Maybe he's actually just been saving the good stuff. He was
Could
like,
be.
"All this comedy, it's easy for me, but this was what I really wanted to do, and now it's shining."
Sure. Yeah, it's pretty impressive. So what did you end up giving Green Book?
I gave it a rare 5. This movie is fantastic, and everybody should watch it.
Yeah. We didn't even mention why the movie is called Green Book.
Apparently when you're driving through the Deep South and you're black, you're in trouble.
Yeah,
so
in the 1960s, you needed to have...
You had a Green Book, which allowed you to see where you could go and you wouldn't have problems.
Isn't that amazing? That here's the restaurants and hotels that you're welcome at.
Yeah.
And if it's not in the book, don't stop.
And we already mentioned this, but then you see the contrast again later where he's invited to play at places that he's not invited to eat.
Yeah.
And that it's powerful. It's
it
very
is.
Powerful.
It is. And so I agree with you. I gave it 5 stars as well. I was
you little trickster.
I know. I'm going to tell you the truth. Off air, I never tell the truth about my scores. No, it's a great movie. It's really, really tremendous. It's a movie that really affected me. I'm rooting for this one.
All right.
So go see Green Book. Go find it. Go watch it. It's great.
I'm going to clap.
Yeah?
You had a great score, sir.
All right, sir. Let's move forward by looking backwards for this week's movie throwback.
Uh-huh.
What do you got for us?
Well, I kind of hinted at it earlier. A Christmas movie that doesn't really feel like a Christmas movie, but it happens during Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be a Christmas movie. Die Hard 2.
Ah, yes.
Bruce Willis back again with the same situation where his wife is in trouble, but this time in an airport. And Bruce Willis has to thwart the bad guys to save his wife one more time. Now, this was made in 1990, and they made a few more Die Hards after this, but this was the last one he was married in, right? It was like the third one he got.
Yeah,
'cause
the third one, she divorced him.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's living with the kid. Yeah, mom's gone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which makes sense.
I love Bonnie Bedelia, too.
She's awesome.
She's great. This movie has a great cast because we bring back Reginald Val Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
So we got him back. You know, you got William Atherton, who's just a scumbag in every movie in the 80s. Ghostbusters, Weird Science, or Real Genius, this movie. You just want to punch him in the mouth.
And you never see him anymore.
Yeah.
He never got out of that I'm just a douchebag
just
from the
80s. Just a snarky 80s guy. You got, you know, early Dennis Franz. And here's the cop. Hey, I'm just a Chicago cop or whatever he is.
Yep.
You know, directed by Rennie Harlan, took over the franchise with this movie. It's really just kind of your classic airport terrorist movie off of the vein of like Airport or Airport 76 or all those movies, right? It's all happening within the airport, and you have a terrorist who has taken over the airwaves of the airport, just crashing planes into the ground.
And they have to find them, and there's some double crossing. This is a pretty action packed, way
is.
Unbelievable, but super fun.
It really does echo the first one a lot of the ways. And it also kind of showcases the difference between Alan Rickman as Hans Gruber and William Sadler as the villain in this one.
Yeah.
You can't touch Alan Rickman. William Sadler tried, but he's a watered down version.
He did have that whole naked Tai Chi type thing going on that felt a little awkward. He's like doing it and he's like weaved it into his remote control.
I think he watched a little too much Roadhouse. He saw Swayze doing his naked Tai Chi and he's like, I can do that.
Yeah.
I can be Swayze.
I'm going to do it naked.
Come on. it's I love this movie. Like, I love the first two Die Hards. They are both Christmas films in my book that are just fun. This one borrows heavily from the original. Like, yeah, we're just going to, you know, we're saying yippee-ki-yay. We're doing all the things. We got Reginald Val Johnson back.
You know,
the wife's in trouble. He's literally in the movie like, oh, doing this again.
You know, sometimes that is not bad. I loved it when they did it with Evil Dead.
I
liked it with Die Hard.
I mean, they're literally just referencing the first movie. Everyone that he passes. Everyone knows what happened at Nakatomi Plaza. Because anyone he talks to, you're like, oh, McClane. That thing that happened at Nakatomi Plaza a few years ago? You're like,
but
the superhero.
Another thing I liked about it is kind of before Bruce Willis really started trying to ruin movies with his, all right, I want a singing bit.
Yeah, yeah.
That's cool.
Before he became Bruno.
Yeah.
Yeah, this was right before Hudson Hawk, if I remember right.
Yeah. And that's always an argument I have with people. Some
whether
people
Hudson
love
Hawk
it, and
is
then
good?
Me, it's just like, ah.
That movie's awful. My goodness.
Yeah, remember Butterfinger? Ah.
So Die Hard 2, though, it's a movie that I love. It's a good 1-2 punch with the first one. And then then the tone changes. You know, the third one, you get Samuel Jackson in there, and Jeremy Irons is the bad guy, Han Gruber's brother.
They get a little more serious, don't they?
That one got serious. Yeah, that one, they're definitely killing people. This one feels like it's, I know it's 1990. This one felt like it was made in 1984.
Yeah.
Because it's just big, like, blow 'em up
cops
action.
Cops that all hate each other, and they're all yelling at each other, and everybody's wrong, and you got to do it my way. You're a loose cannon.
Over the top. Everyone's carrying an Uzi for some reason.
Yeah, that's how it works.
That's how it works. All right, sir. Let's take some time here to look ahead at what is going to be coming soon. The weekend, well, it's not even a weekend. December 12th, that's a Wednesday. We have the, it's a weird thing. I don't remember ever seeing this. We have Deadpool 2 again.
Yeah.
This time it's called Once Upon a Deadpool. It is the family-friendly version of Deadpool 2.
I think this is a first. It really is.
Yeah.
You have a rated R movie, and they decided, we are successful at this. We're going to re-release it, make it PG-13.
Reshoot 20 minutes of the movie. Let's make it PG-13.
Usually
so
goes
weird.
The other way around. They go, oh, this is the uncut. Now it's
right.
Rated R.
Here's the director's cut. Like, no, we're watering it down. We're changing it. We're going to re-release it. See how it works.
And I can't
we need to make more money off this movie.
I can't make up my mind if this is a money grab or is this a mitzvah for fans who just can't see
Deadpool.
I don't know.
I'm
kind of thinking it's the other. Yeah. I can see Ryan Reynolds going, you know what? A lot of kids shouldn't be watching Deadpool. Let's make them something they can watch.
It's an interesting experiment to me just
yeah.
to see how this works out. And then December 14th, we have a few movies. We have one called Mortal Engines. Looks pretty good to me. I've been kind of curious with this trailer. You also have Clint Eastwood. Now, there's talk that this is Clint Eastwood's final film. I don't believe it. But
like Ozzy Osbourne's final tour?
Sure, the
Part
No
two.
More Tours tour. we have The Mule, where Clint Eastwood directs and stars in this one. Mm-hmm. You know, you got your Bradley Cooper in there. He's a drug mule, apparently. It sounds interesting to me.
Yeah.
Clint Eastwood, when he's on, is a great director.
He's looking his age. He definitely
Absolutely.
Is now.
Yeah.
Where before, he was older, but now he looks frail. At least in this.
Does.
That's how
Doddering.
He's portrayed in the
We also have Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Looking forward to that quite a bit. That looks pretty good.
That's one of my top 10 from last year.
That it is. Finally. Hey, that might be the seventh one that's coming out. But
yeah.
and then the last one is a smaller release, but it's a film that I've been hearing great things about. It's called If Beale Street Could Talk. Don't expect to find that in theaters near you, but it's coming out in small releases if you live on a coast.
Nice.
Yeah.
Ex Machina when that came out.
Yeah, boy, I just watched it again the other night.
Oh,
it's going to be so
movie.
Good. It holds up so well. Anyways, those are the movies that are going to be coming out that week. And I'll tell you what, as I'm looking ahead at the end of the month, boy, the weekend of Christmas, we'll be talking about it next week and are looking ahead, but there's like 9 new releases that come out that weekend. It's insane.
I feel like I should have saved more vacation time for that
just
week.
Just take off.
Yeah.
I'm just going to watch movies, man.
I'm not going to see anybody for a while.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting, but there's they always save the good ones to the end, it seems like.
Yeah.
Before we leave you, of course, we want to thank our sponsor, Marcus Theaters, the Palace Cinema here in Sun Prairie. Thank you for sponsoring us. We've had a lot of fun this year doing some remotes there. We're looking forward to doing another one there soon. But you can do no better than the Palace Cinema.
Do we have a plan?
Not yet. I'll talk. We'll talk.
Okay.
We'll talk.
All right.
Yeah. Maybe Santa will show up. Who knows?
Noise. Yeah, it's kind of like that Tim Allen movie. Just you keep on looking more and more like Santa every week.
Thing is, it's for no reason. It's just happening.
Did you kill Santa?
I don't know what happened.
Because I believe that's what happened to
Tim
Allen.
I picked a hat up off the ground, put it on. I don't know. Something happened.
Yeah,
I suddenly got fat. That suddenly.
I would get a blood test.
All right. Of course, if you want to find more from us, you can find us online anytime. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter. Just search Real Reviews TV. You can also download our channel for your Roku or Apple TV devices. Just search for KSUN, KSUN. The channel on there, click on it, it's free. You can watch our programming right there in your TV if you have Apple TV or Roku. You can also find us online by going to YouTube's. Just search Real Reviews, KSUN again. KSUN is our channel. Search those, you can find us, you can watch us at your leisure. There is 300, this is episode 300, sorry, 300. 241.
I was going to say, I missed the
milestone. We missed
the milestone.
Couple of them. It's episode 241 this week.
Nice.
Yes. So anyways, that's all that. Next week, we're going to be talking about such hilarious films as Schindler's List, and Can You Ever Forgive Me, and probably something else. We'll see.
I bet there's a spot in hell for people who say things like that.
I know. Got mine reserved. But anyways, we'll be talking about those films as well as something else. But until we meet again, I'm Jamison.
I'm Mike Roth.
Thanks for watching.